Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is entitled The Holy Spirit and Spirituality. This is lesson number 11 in that series. We're only going to have 12 in this series. This is lesson number 11, entitled Grieving and Resisting the Holy Spirit, and it's the lesson for March 18 of 2017. Before we begin, this is a challenging and very important subject, so I'd like to ask you to join us in a word of prayer. Our kind and wonderful Father, it's hard to imagine anything scarier to a believer in Jesus than grieving the Holy Spirit. Help us to understand more of what's involved in that and how we can perpetually and forever avoid it is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, through this quarter, we've talked about various ways in which we can interact with the Holy Spirit. And we've discovered that the Holy Spirit does a lot of different things. And I would like to, as sort of a summary, mention four levels at which the Holy Spirit interacts with human beings. And these four levels are important because sometimes we get confused because we mix up the levels. So let's just look at those briefly. Number one. He keeps us alive physically. Every beat of the heart and every molecular reaction that happens that keeps that heart beating and the lungs working and the brain working, etc., is directly a result of God's power. Acts 17, 25, 28, and a number of other passages in Scripture. Two, he woos sinners, encouraging them to become followers of Jesus. And there are a number of passages in Scripture that suggests that, but he tries to draw us. He tries to, whoever we are, he says, come on in, learn about Jesus, learn the truth. Then three, he convicts and converts those who respond. And that, of course, is one of his very important jobs. He says, okay, make a decision, make a commitment, turn to Jesus, etc. And then finally, number four, we remember some lessons we've had on the gifts of the Spirit. He gifts those who are prepared to receive Him so they can work to reach out to others. So those are the four levels. He keeps us alive, He woos us, He convicts and converts us, and then He gifts us to reach out to others. The gifts are not to prove that we are Christians or some other thing like that, as some church groups would suggest. The gifts are there to help us reach out to others. But there's one very important caveat, if we want to call it that, on the Holy Spirit's power. He will not, he never will force himself upon anyone. Those who are enticed by sin and choose to rather to follow a selfish path like Satan himself did, quench the Spirit. If we are determined to go our own selfish ways, despite the Holy Spirit's best efforts, finally He will have to let us go. And perhaps you can remember the famous text in Hosea 4, verse 7. The people of Israel are under the spell of idols. Let them go their own way.
Verse 17.
It's verse 17. Thank you.
And if they're under a spell of something, they have an evil spirit,
yeah,
aren't they?
Yeah, exactly. Well, we're going to also talk, as we get toward the end of our lesson, about the unpardonable sin. Let me just read a couple of verses and so you can be thinking about that. Here's Matthew 12, 31 and 32. And so I tell you that people can be forgiven any sin. Notice that. They can be forgiven any sin and any evil thing they say, but whoever says evil things against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. So you think about what that means as we work our way through this lesson. Well, we believe now that the Holy Spirit works with angels, works with our guardian angel, work with other angelic groups to try to convict us, to convert us, to attract us to Jesus. There is no other agency. There's not some other separate force that's out there trying to convince us and convert us. So if there's one path to heaven and you reject that one path, what else is there left? So ultimately, we would be left by the Holy Spirit if we continually, again and again and again, grieve Him, reject Him, etc. Ellen White had some very interesting words, and let's look at the background of those. Look at Acts 7, verse 51. Remember, Stephen was a very powerful and very persuasive speaker, and after he was chosen as the leader of the seven deacons, he went around to the different churches, particularly the Greek-speaking churches in the Jerusalem area, and said, you know, this Jesus is the one who's the fulfillment of prophecy, and he was so compelling and so convincing in his arguments that they just couldn't stand it. And they brought him before the Sanhedrin to be judged and condemned. And he realized as he was getting near the end of his long sermon, this is the longest sermon in the entire Bible, he realized that they were getting very, very upset by his arguments. And he responds, "How stubborn you are," Stephen went on to say, "how heathen your hearts, how deaf you are to God's message. You are just like your ancestors. You too have always resisted the Holy Spirit." What is implied by that? Well, rebelling against God's plan of salvation is a foolish and deadly thing to do. God will never force anyone to do His will. He refuses to violate our freedom. So let's look at that, and that's documented. This is in the early pages of Desire of Ages, page 22, the first paragraph. "The earth was dark through a misapprehension of God, that the gloomy shadows might be lightened, that the world might be brought back to God." See, that's what the Holy Spirit does. He's trying to bring us back to God. "Satan's deceptive power was to be broken. This could not be done by force. The exercise of force is contrary to the principles of God's government. He desires only the service of love, and love cannot be commanded. It cannot be won by force or authority. Only by love is love awakened." If God could win the great controversy by force, how long would it take for the controversy to be over? Just a matter of seconds. He would have dealt with it back when it started in heaven, if it could be won by force.
Wait a minute. Do you think it could be won by force?
No, I'm saying if it could be won by force.
If it could be won by force.
If it could be won by force, then God would have just done it right back in the beginning. Okay. To know God is to love Him. His character must be manifested in contrast to the character of Satan. I'm reading again from Ellen White. "This work only one being in all the universe could do. Only he who knew the height and depth of the love of God could make it known. Upon the world's dark night, the sun," that's S-U-N in this case, but capitalized, "of righteousness must rise with healing in his wings." And you remember the passage in Malachi 4, verse 2.
If we define God as love, how could we even speculate on him using force? It doesn't even compute. We talk about, well, God could make automatons. Well, that's there's no love in that, yeah, because it's purely dancing like a marionette or whatever.
There's such thing as discipline too, though.
Yeah, but your discipline.
What does that have to do with love?
Educational.
Because a lot of you ever heard of tough love?
Yes.
Well, tough love does not seem like love when it's given to you.
Yeah. But the purpose of it is for education purposes. So ultimately, they'll get to the goal rationally, not through force and intimidation, yeah, and
all
coercion
I'm
and extortion.
Is that sometimes it doesn't look like God loves us.
Well, I'm not
arguing.
Well,
and that's not what the Israelites thought at the bottom of Mount Sinai. They were pretty much afraid. And those kind of things happen. And as we know, the story of the Old Testament is this up and down between God, you know, scaring them to death, and so, oh yes, anything you say, we'll do it. And then God says, oh no, relax a little bit. I really love you. I want to have a relationship with you. Oh, okay, if you're relaxing, fine. We can go back to our old ways. And it's the story of the Old Testament.
This citation, Desire of Ages, page 22. I mean, that definition is so succinct and so powerful, mm-hmm, that I don't think a lot of people could appreciate it.
Yeah. Well, why were the Sanhedrin so upset at Stephen's behavior, his speeches and his work?
They thought they'd gotten rid of the big thorn in their side, and here he is pushing it even further, and it's gaining ground.
Yes, Christianity is exploding. 3,000 people baptized in one day, and pretty soon there's 5,000 more, and they thought they killed Jesus, and this whole thing was going to blow over. So now it's 3.5 years later, and instead of getting worse, instead of dying out, it's just getting bigger and bigger.
Not only that, but he is proving that Jesus is in fact resurrected.
Yeah.
Because everything he says, everything he does is done in the name of Jesus.
Right. Yeah, it's a little hard to deny somebody who's been sitting by the gate at the temple there for years because he's crippled, and someone comes along in the name of Jesus and raises him to life. Okay, how are you going to explain this away? The guy is standing there jumping up and down, you know?
Do you think that maybe they were understanding the spirit and it kind of dawned on them that they can't kill the spirit?
I wish I could give them that much credit.
I don't know. I mean, how else would you explain all that?
Well, they were so angry. Of course, they just took Stephen out and they stoned him. Mm-hmm. So why is it, do you think, that God absolutely insists on allowing us our personal freedom? Wouldn't it be better if he just used a little bit of force? I know a lady who one time came up to Dr. Graham Maxwell, who was giving a talk on freedom after the presentation. She says, I would be very happy to give away half my freedom if the Lord would just save everybody.
Three words. God is love.
Yeah.
And there's a lot, everything flows from that. If anything else, if you try to work your way around it and try to, it's freedom is part of the freedom to choose.
Plus, that's a contradiction of action.
Yeah.
Because if I can give away half my freedom to save everybody, well, then you're not really being saved.
Well, what is save? Save means to teach, to heal. Yeah. It's to teach you to change your thinking, but not through force or fear or threats and intimidation and coercion and extortion.
Yeah. Just think how, go ahead, Gordon.
On the other hand, in our daily life, not religious life, but in our living in the United States, you know, we do give up some freedom in order to have security.
Well, and the larger group of people you live among, the more freedoms you have to give up.
Yeah.
Because one somehow or other, you're going to violate somebody else's freedom by something that you want to do. If you live all by yourself, miles and miles from anybody else, you can do whatever you want.
Unless somebody else finds out about it.
Yeah.
And then meddlers will come in and want to change it.
I knew a Lutheran pastor once who said, kind of on the side, that I know that there are people going to be lost, but I would like to think that God would just say, I love you so much, I'm not going to let you make this particular choice, so I'm going to save you.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's a matter of moving us from here to heaven. That's a concept that some people think of. You know, if I'm going to be saved, that means going to heaven. But it's really about the relationship. It's about reestablishing and hooking up with God again. And our will has to be molded, shaped, softened in order to do that, because our basic nature is through cultivation of habit, and also through what happened at the Garden of Eden, is to resist God's will.
Yeah.
So
think how, if God really wanted to use force, let's just think of some times in history, he could have just prevented Satan from doing what he did in heaven. He could have prevented Eve from touching the tree. He could have prevented Eve, even after she touched the tree, he could have prevented her from taking the fruit.
There's no love involved in those speculations.
I'm just saying, if there was any force, it would have been very easy for God to use it if he wanted to go that route.
But if God destroyed even 1% of our freedom, love would no longer be possible. No.
Yeah.
It has to be total freedom or there's no love.
And the freedom is to exercise self-control.
Yeah.
And self-control takes time, education, to learn, because you can't put a bunch of people together if individually they don't have self-control. Otherwise, you got to have some policemen or prisons or whatever. It's not going to be there. It doesn't work.
Yeah, there's not going to be any sin things in heaven.
We have thousands of years of learning that laws and rules and regulations and force and intimidation and extortion do not work, period.
Well, that's right. In the book of Hebrews, and I believe it was written by Paul, probably with some help from Luke, says in chapter 10, verse 24 and 25, let us be concerned for one another. Now we're talking about love now. Let us be concerned for one another, to help one another, to show love and to do good. Let us not give up the habit of meeting together, as some are doing. Instead, let us encourage one another all the more, since you see that the day of the Lord is coming nearer. So, there are many passages in Scripture suggesting that we need to help each other in the community of believers. So why is it that there are so many churches? Shouldn't love be just pulling all Christians together? There's a certain church that now just says we should all return to the motherfold and we should love each other. We shouldn't be separated like this.
And with a hierarchy.
With a hierarchy.
And it doesn't work, period. You know, we're taught back to fantasy land. You know, Disneyland's, what, 60 miles away or 50 miles away, and people are attracted to that stuff. Yeah. People are attracted to movies of fantasies. You know, real life for eternity, that has nothing to contribute that is positive.
Well, one of the reasons why there are so many different churches is people have, and I've just been listening this week to some of the experiences of Martin Luther. People have different ideas, different ways of interpreting Scripture. And so many people, unfortunately, in our day, are reading the Scripture looking for something to support their already held views, as opposed to reading the Scripture saying, what can I discover about God in this book, in these books, in this context?
Well, sometimes you have to do that. You get an idea and you go to the Bible and you look for it.
Yeah.
If you don't find it, well, then you got to change some things.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, there are some people who are just so determined that they think they find it even if it's not there. Mm-hmm.
Or they think God just spoken to them the other night.
Yeah. Well, it's easy to read the Old Testament, as we know, and be critical of Israel. But how would we survive, and what would it look like if God wrote a book about us and all our ups and downs and reporting our activities of every day? Well, you can think about that. I'll leave that one up to you. What can we do to help ourselves and others in loving ways? How are we? Are we responsible?
By example.
By example, okay.
And then giving people the choice to follow, or giving them other work to do based on what you're doing.
Okay. Well, here's what Ellen White says. This love. This is talking about the Christian agape love, is the evidence of their discipleship. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, said Jesus, if you have love one to another. You remember that famous verse, it's John 13:35. And that raises the question. What is implied by the fact that Jesus said, if you really love each other, the whole world will know that you are my disciples? Does that imply that nobody out there in the world loves?
Just do things differently. They'll pick it up real fast.
Well, she goes on to say, when men are bound together, not by force or self-interest, but by love, they show the working of an influence that is above every human influence. Where this oneness exists, it is evidence that the image of God is being restored in humanity, that a new principle of life has been implanted. It shows that there is power in the divine nature to withstand the supernatural agencies of evil, and that the grace of God subdues the selfishness inherent in the natural heart. Desire of Ages 6:78. So that would be a pretty phenomenal change, wouldn't it? Pretty incredible if that could really happen. Well, what about Ephesians 4, verse 30? And do not make God's Holy Spirit sad, for the Spirit is God's mark of ownership on you, a guarantee that the day will come when God will set you free. What's another word for God's mark of ownership?
Seal.
This seal. Mm-hmm. Exactly. And in Revelation talks about the sealing, doesn't it? Even the Old Testament, Isaiah 63:9-10, talks about it. So how is it possible to grieve the Holy Spirit?
Reject.
Well, grieving has to do with loss. So if we are in a relationship with the Holy, with God through the Holy Spirit, then when we pull away, there's grieving because there's loss.
Okay. Let's be clear, very clear. Second Peter and other places in the Bible, Second Peter chapter 3 is very clear about this. God would like to save everybody. If it were possible, he would save everybody, even the devil, if it were possible. Well, when we repeatedly reject the Holy Spirit's approaches and every offer of help that he gives, he will finally and sadly turn away, leaving us to our own choices and the consequences of those choices.
When we say turn away, do you remember, you got, I've had enough, or does he just let you go?
Well, he lets you go.
How, I mean, because I think that his turning away is rather inactive. It's just, maybe some people think it's
really
God's...
Really, you turn away from him.
Exactly. And that's what you're rejecting whatever it takes to change your thinking, to be in harmony with the way that creation was designed to run. And what can he do? He can't just keep pummeling you from...
Well, with his foreknowledge... He mustn't be able to know, be able to tell, if you're just beyond hope.
I agree with that.
Well, the fact that the Holy Spirit can be grieved is one of the proofs that he's a personal being, not just some kind of divine force or influence. Well, look at John 16:8. This is one of the key passages about the Holy Spirit, where Jesus talks about he's going to send the Holy Spirit and what will he do and so forth. John 16, verse 8, and when he comes, he will prove to the people of the world that they are wrong about sin and about what is right and about God's judgment. So three things, sin, what is right or what's righteousness, and about God's judgment. So what does the Holy Spirit teach us about those three things? Well, do we have a clear understanding of the great controversy and what is involved in the charges that Satan has made against God? Is it clear to us? Do we clearly understand the fact that all three members of the Godhead hate sin? Now, why do they hate sin? It's not just because we're rejecting them. It's because they know what sin does to us. I mean, if you saw your child killing himself, would you say, oh, well, okay, up to you? Or would you do everything you possibly could to prevent it? All heaven, by contrast, we have some incredible verses in Luke 15, verses 7 and 10. All heaven rejoices when someone comes back to God. And it's, I quote, in the same way I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 respectable people who do not need to repent. Now, I'd kind of like to be one of those respectable people, wouldn't you? But there's joy in heaven when people repent. So God recognizes, and another reason, I'm just going through the ways that God, how God feels about all this. God knows the kind of place that he's prepared for us. And he knows what a wonderful privilege it will be to live there and to communicate with him and to, you know, to fellowship with him and so forth like this. And he's trying everything he can do to bring us into that situation. We can't even comprehend it. Remember, 1 Corinthians 2:9 says, however, as the scripture says, what no one ever saw or heard, what no one even ever thought could happen, is the very thing God prepared for those who love him. Well, so obviously it makes the Godhead very sad when we reject him. Well, Ephesians 4 is a great chapter if you're trying to understand something about the work of the Holy Spirit. Let me just pick out a few verses. Ephesians 4, verses 2 and 3. Be always humble, gentle, and patient. Show your love by being tolerant with one another. Do your best to preserve the unity which the Spirit gives by means of the peace that binds you together. And we could go on. Look at verses 15 and 17. Instead, by speaking the truth in the spirit of love, we must grow up in every way to Christ, who is the head. Under his control, all the different parts of the body fit together, and the whole body is held together by every joint with which it is provided. Remember, this is his context in which he talks about how the church is like a body. So when each separate part works as it should, the whole body grows and builds itself up through love. In the Lord's name, then, I warn you, do not continue to live like the heathen, whose thoughts are worthless and whose minds are in the dark, and so forth. Well, so when we accept the advice of the Holy Spirit, we follow Christ, he becomes our guide, and we do not follow the customs and foolish ways of the world. Instead, we live a life pleasing to God. Well, by contrast, Ephesians 4 talks about the other side of the picture, starting with verse 25. No more lying then. Each of you must tell the truth to one another, because we are all members together in the body of Christ. I mean, what does it do to a group when you lie to somebody? If you become angry, do not let your anger lead you into sin, and do not stay angry all day. Don't give the devil a chance. Those who used to rob must stop robbing and start working in order to earn an honest living for themselves and to be able to help the poor. Do not use harmful words, but only helpful words, the kind that build up and provide what is needed, so that what you say will do good to those who hear you. And do not make God's Holy Spirit sad, for the Spirit is God's mark of ownership on you. We already looked at this. A guarantee that the day will come when God will set you free. Get rid of all bitterness, passion, and anger. No more shouting or insults. No more hateful feelings or of any sort. Instead, be kind and tenderhearted to one another and forgive one another as God has forgiven you through Christ. That's quite a chapter of contrast, huh? Well, if we spurn God's efforts to reach us, what happens?
We remain dead.
Okay. Yeah.
No way.
What do we gain by lying? I mean, look, think of some of the things that are mentioned there. What do we really gain by lying, anger, accepting the devil's temptations, stealing, failing to work, not supporting the poor, using harmful words, grieving the Holy Spirit? Is there anything in that list that really is beneficial to us in any way? I basically don't watch especially movies on TV, but I've noticed in the few I have seen that quite often it'll start out with somebody telling a lie, and then it just snowballs. You have to tell a different kind of a lie to cover that one, and then finally, of course, they end up getting caught. I mean, you'd think that people would learn that lesson after a while. Well, there are a lot of Christians who believe that God is so sovereign, so high up there and way above us that nothing we can do can affect him in any way. Well, but in our discussions last quarter, and talking about Job, it seemed to be that God actually put his reputation on the line for Job. Is that really possible? Would God ever do such a thing? Well, I had one person respond, well, no, God didn't put himself on the line with Job. He had foreknowledge. He knew how it was going to work out. But that's exactly the point. The devil doesn't believe that God's foreknowledge is accurate. That's precisely the point. Okay? So Satan is challenging God's foreknowledge. God says Job is faithful and upright. He's righteous. What do we find at the end of the book? These other friends who came to so-called, at least thought they were going to straighten Job out, they were wrong. Well, did God put his reputation on the line in the case of Jesus Christ? There's an incredible...
By associating with us, it sort of it muddies his reputation, you know. Well, he eats and drinks with sinners.
Yeah.
Which, of course, the immediate context. But in the same way that if somebody, an American, goes overseas and does horrendous things, it reflects on... Yep. On the country, our country, and the same way that when God associates himself with us, it sort of muddies his throne. And so the cleansing of the sanctuary has to do with vindicating God's character in saving us.
Absolutely. Christ's Obsolescence, page 196, paragraph 4. The value of a soul, who can estimate? Would you know it's worth? Go to Gethsemane and there watch with Christ through those hours of anguish, where he sweats, as it were, great drops of blood. Look upon the Savior uplifted on the cross. Hear that despairing cry, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Mark 15:34. Look upon the wounded head, the pierced side, the marred feet. Remember that Christ risked all. For our redemption, heaven itself was imperiled. At the foot of the cross, remembering that for one sinner, Christ would have laid down his life, you may estimate the value of a soul. Wow. What would have happened if Christ had sinned?
It'd be over.
It would be over. This would prove that there's no one in the universe that you can ultimately trust. Even God is not trustworthy. And I think the whole universe would sooner or later just fall apart, destroy itself.
Probably fairly soon.
Probably fairly soon. By contrast, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, Paul said the things we read in Ephesians 4. Things we should do, we should, 1, speak the truth in love. 2, although we may become angry about sin, we must not sin in our anger. 3, we should work with our own hands and use the products of our labor to do good for the needy. 4, we should speak in an edifying manner and impart grace to our hearers. And 5, we should be kind, tender-hearted, and forgiving. What would it be like to live in a society where everybody did that?
It would be heaven.
Yes.
Really? What a surprise, huh? Well, don't we in fact believe that Jesus Christ is our model? Didn't he do those things? If so, shouldn't we be allowing the Holy Spirit to change us so that we become more and more like him? What would happen, or what does happen, if our efforts at reaching out to others and what we say about Christians and how they behave do not match our actual record? You've heard the old saying, do as I say, not as I do, right? What happens if Christians talk about love and kindness and all that kind of stuff, and behind the scenes in our actual behavior we're hating and we're misbehaving and so forth? What do people looking on think?
Hypocrite.
Hypocrite, right. And certainly that would grieve the Holy Spirit. God has waited, remember, 2,000 years since his death on the cross for people to stand up, honor his name, and be so faithful to him that nothing the devil can do can cause them to give up. When those conditions are met, Jesus can come again.
You may be talking corporately, because there have been people all through the centuries here that were martyrs. Mm-hmm. And in Revelation 5, no, not. Well, the fifth seal mm-hmm. opens, and the souls under the altar are crying out for God to act on their behalf, because they've been killed. Yeah. So there have been some through the ages, but there'll be a special.
A few here and there, one or two maybe.
Job, Moses,
yeah.
Elijah.
Yeah. And I would probably add to that list some of the people who were burned at the stake in the days of the Reformation. I mean, what about
fed
Huss,
lions,
Jerome?
Or fed to lions.
Fed to lions, yeah. Why not?
Well, are we talking about big strength here?
We're talking about people who will stand up and say, I will not misrepresent God even if I have to die for it. That's what we're talking about. We're not talking about physical strength.
Are you going to know what it is to represent him to that nth of a degree? Because it seems like there'll always be a question whether or not you've reached all the way to God's character or not. And if there's always a question, there might be...
The point isn't whether we reached all the way to, at least in my mind, is not whether we reached all the way to God's character, but we've reached enough so that the devil can't mislead us.
Not only that, but if we're progressing and it's visible that there is progress, how can we argue that God is not involved in that progress?
Do we really believe Jesus' words in John 13:35, if we really loved each other, the whole world would notice? Is that? I mean, he's not talking about loving everybody. Jesus wasn't even talking about loving the world out there. See, if we loved each other.
Yeah, but the love he has in mind is so beyond everything that we think is love. And I think that's one of the reasons Jesus came, was mm-hmm. to show us what love is. Number one, then he shows us how to become more loving. And finally, he shows us how far we should go with our love, which is all the way to the giving up of your own life, because love should be more important to us than our own life.
So what would be the demonstration that would go that far?
That's right.
The ultimate demonstration.
I mean, you
can
say it in words, yeah, like yes. you just well, did, but what are we going to see when
let
that
Let me give
happens?
You an example, at least a possible example. How many people, if they walk into a Seventh-day Adventist church for the first time, feel the love? And I'm intentionally, you know how people say on programs and so forth, oh, I feel the love, you know.
So how would you answer that?
Love is not a feeling,
it's a
principle.
What kind of answer are you looking for there?
I'm saying if a person comes into an Adventist church, do they feel welcome? They feel like, are they excited to come back? Those kinds of things.
So,
I'll just give you a personal experience. I know a young couple. They're not so young now, but they used to be quite young. That when they finished an Adventist college, they walked out the door. They said to their friends, "Don't ever talk to me about Christianity ever again." And I don't even know how many years, maybe 20 years later, one of those friends dared to mention a class we were having in there. I was taking people through the Bible book by book, and believe it or not, we were talking about Revelation 14. I just can't believe this. And, you know, the three angels' messages and so forth. And somehow or other, this couple decided that they were going to come. This lady had said a couple words, and this couple decided to come to my class on Revelation 14. And they never stopped. Yeah. I've had other times when I've had, I don't talk about my experience, but more than once I've had someone, I've said one or two things to somebody in a situation, and one lady came to church, she says, "I'll come and I'll just see what your church is like." Never stopped. She ended up being a professor at Loma Linda University.
So was that a result of love, or was it the result of things making sense, or things?
Well, that's the question I'm throwing to you.
I mean, what kind of love did you give that would make her change her mind? I mean, you were just talking, weren't you? Yeah. Weren't you just talking about the Bible and whatever? Yeah. So I thought what I was looking for is some sort of demonstration, not a teaching.
Well, I guess I should invite those people here and say, what was it that attracted you?
I know for a surety that one of the examples you used, it was because it made sense.
I think that's probably one of the biggest things.
Yeah, it made sense. I'm sure that's true. And I think that's part of the love.
And also the spirit that you're of. It's mm-hmm. not, yes, it's you know, it's like talking to your dog, for instance.
Yeah.
You could say very sweet words, but if you say them in an angry way, they will. They get that feeling. Or if you say terrible things, you know, "You terrible dog," you know, in a sweet way, they don't get the.
Well, even your kids, if they're young enough,
they get the spirit of that. And so, if you're accepting, you're friendly, you're open. You know, the knowledge is icing on the cake.
So if people saw that happening outside of the church, it would change their mind?
It does sometimes.
A lot of that is interrelated. You take it on get away from our local scene and think back on some of the more recent history. Mother Teresa, Albert Schweitzer, spent most of his life in Africa, and yet he was one of the world's most famous organists. There are people, when they do this, people notice, they really do notice, and particularly when people make their life work doing that stuff.
Well,
I think they really have to understand the logic behind love before they can even put it in practice. It's like everything else. We must understand the theory of it before we can go into the action of that theory.
Yeah.
And what is beautiful about Revelation 14 is that we get some theory. We've got to come out of the world. Come out of what? A world that doesn't love itself, doesn't love one another, and come into an understanding of love. And that opens the door then to, oh, that's a new perspective on love, one whereby love is more important than life, as it was for Jesus. And that changes people.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the church is supposed to be the temple of God, yes?
We're talking about love and how and teaching and so forth. When Jesus was talking to Pilate, he says, why were you born? He says, for this reason I came into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Mm-hmm. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. That's the second sentence. Yeah. Another way of saying that second sentence is, if they have an interest in the truth, it'll have some impact on them. But if they're not searching for truth, truth is available. Mm-hmm. But if they're not searching for it, or it doesn't make sense to them, they're of course, is it truth if it doesn't make? Is it really truth if it doesn't make sense?
Yeah.
And is it love if it doesn't make sense?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Are you doing them a favor by not telling people the truth?
Okay, so let's come back to the main point of our lesson here. How do we quench the Holy Spirit? What does that mean? Look, for example, at Ephesians 6, verse 16. At all times carry faith as a shield, for with it you will be able to put out all the burning arrows shot by the evil one. Okay, that's...
Before you go on that, we want to start at verse 12.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the context is that Satan's going around like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And so then we go on to up to verse 16.
We just, verse 12, we are not fighting against human beings, but against the wicked spiritual forces in the heavenly world, the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers of this dark age, and so forth. Yeah, very.
So this is the what Jesus has to offer is the antidote.
Yeah. Well, there are two very important things that the Holy Spirit does for us, with us, to try to protect us. One, he reveals to us the truth. That's what we've just been talking about. People are, you say something that's really convincing, they say, yeah, that makes sense. He reveals to us the truth about sin in the setting of the great controversy. And two, by revealing to us the truth about Jesus and his ministry, he gives us power to overcome sin if we're willing to work with him. Without the Spirit's help, we do not have the remotest chance of overcoming sin and becoming like Jesus. Well, two of the most serious ways in which we can ignore the Holy Spirit and quench his fire in our lives are by ignoring the truths that the Bible teaches and despising prophetic utterances. And we have verses for that. Just for one example, is 1 Thessalonians 5:20. Well, let's look at 19. Do not restrain the Holy Spirit. Do not despise inspired messages. If we're knocking the Bible every time we get a chance, how can the Holy Spirit work with us? This doesn't mean we should just accept sort of anything anybody says is claiming to be, a preacher or saint or whatever he's claiming to be. We need to be very discerning listeners. We've talked about this before, but it's not our job to judge other people, but it is our job to judge what they say. Is it the truth? See? We need to be very discerning listeners, and of course, who are the examples in the Bible and the book of Acts of that? The Bereans, right? They checked on everything Paul said. So as believing Christians, we need to walk in the Spirit. Galatians 5:25, remember that verse? The Spirit has given us life. We've talked about that back at the beginning of our lesson. He must also control our lives. Hold on now. I thought we talked about the Holy Spirit doesn't use any force. How can he control our lives if he doesn't use any force?
Persuasion.
Telling us the truth. And I believe that if we really come to love God and we really understand what Jesus came to teach, we will get to the place where we're so attracted by that we wouldn't choose to do anything against that. We're just drawn to Jesus. Well, one of the things we must avoid is twisting the scriptures by interpreting them in ways that nullify their impact. We've already talked a little bit about this. Here's a comment from Ellen White that I think is very, very important. This is volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 331, paragraph 2. The Bible with its precious gems of truth was not written for the scholar alone. On the contrary, it was designed for the common people. And the interpretation given by the common people, when aided by the Holy Spirit, accords best with the truth as it is in Jesus. The great truths necessary for salvation are made clear as the noonday, and none will mistake and lose their way except those who follow their own judgment instead of the plainly revealed will of God. So, that means if you hear some preacher standing up there and reading a text and then sort of twisting it and working it, changing it around, so you better be careful, right? 1 Thessalonians 4, 7, 8, another part of this whole story. God did not call us to live in immorality, but in holiness. So then, whoever rejects this teaching is not rejecting a human being, but God, who gives you His Holy Spirit. So it's through the Holy Spirit that we have the capacity even to overcome our sins and our blasphemies. So now, let's try to get to our final challenge here. What is the sin against the Holy Spirit? Let's look at these verses really quick. Mark 3, 28 and 29. I assure you that people can be forgiven all their sins and all the evil things they may say, but whoever says evil things against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven, because he has committed an eternal sin. What is that? Luke 12, verse 10 says, whoever says a word against the Son of Man can be forgiven, but those who say evil things against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. Is that because the Holy Spirit is not as forgiving as other members of the Godhead? Well, Matthew 12, 31 and 32, and so I tell you that people can be forgiven any sin and any evil thing they say, but whoever says evil things against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven.
Is that what it really says is forgiven? Is that what the Greek would lead you to believe? Or is that the presupposition on the part of the translator?
Hold on, we'll look at that for just a second real quick, and I'll see if I can answer that.
I mean, is the person, when God lets you go, is that person forgiven? Or is he's not willing to receive remission? Which means healing, right?
Right.
Because the problem is a disease. Sin is a disease. If you have a disease, forgiveness doesn't solve your problem.
Aphasis
is remission rather than.
Now we have a problem with Bible translations.
We do.
Again.
Well,
every time.
That's forgiveness, to pardon, to forgive, forgiveness, aphemi, aphemi.
Well, that's what we say because of our theology. But the real meaning of the word is healing. It's a transformation. Elsewhere it's translated remission. Mm-hmm. Remission implies that there is progress towards healing.
Yeah.
A disease needs healing if the person desires healing. Mm-hmm. And you can't force healing on somebody that doesn't want it, but it takes following the recommendation, the recipe and so forth, the prescription.
What are the implications of this? Well, a persistently rebellious attitude toward God and His plan of salvation disqualifies us from being Christians. There's
well, that's grieving the spirit there.
Yeah, right
there.
Yeah.
Because it's a continual.
Yeah.
It's as long as you continually.
Yeah.
Don't want it.
Okay. Let's spell that out a little bit more. There's been a great deal of misunderstanding and anguish over the unpardonable sin. In actual fact, if you're worried about having committed the unpardonable sin, you've not committed it.
Right.
We can say that. In fact, there's no sin that cannot be forgiven. However, there are people who are unwilling to ask for forgiveness and those who are unwilling to accept God's forgiveness. So what's the difference there?
I think the latter is probably more important because you can... You don't need to. Everybody is forgiven, and a lot
God
of people there.
They're personified.
Yeah, I mean that's His nature. Mm-hmm. But some people you say that to, and you'll just turn them off, and they'll never want to talk to you again. Yeah.
Well, our Bible study guide says, blasphemy against the Holy Spirit, therefore, must be understood as a deliberate and persistent repudiation of Jesus' saving work. It occurs when an individual willfully and obstinately resists the Spirit's testimony to Christ and his salvation and grace. So what do you think of that explanation?
Well, I looked up blasphemy in the dictionary just to clarify, and it says two things. One, the act of depriving something of its sacred character.
Okay.
And the other one is claiming the attributes or prerogatives of deity. So that's why they accused Jesus of blasphemy when he said what he said about himself.
Yeah.
That he had been there. Used the term I am.
Yeah. Well, here's a very interesting quotation. Ellen White originally wrote to Loma Linda. Those who would not receive Christ were dead in trespasses and sin. And she's talking about, obviously, mostly the Pharisees. As they looked upon the evidences that he presented by curing disease and making the suffering ones rejoice in health, why did they not yield their unbelief? Because by such an action, they would have confessed themselves to be sinners. In the place of receiving the evidence offered them, in the place of recognizing in Christ's works the endowment of heaven, they held right on to their wicked purposes and said, he performed this wonderful work through the devil. This was the sin against the Holy Ghost. They had not forgiveness in this world nor in the world to come. That's Loma Linda Messages 155 and 156.
Don't you think that if I was a truth unto myself, I would feel like I've got the truth, that I don't have to change? It's kind of like a blasphemy there, because you're not God. So you're not a truth unto yourself. Yeah. You need to go to him. Mm-hmm. And if you don't accept the Spirit, that means you are a truth unto yourself.
We as a church have sometimes suggested that we're on the right path because we have the truth. I think the end time people of God will not be the people who have the truth. It will be people who, let me see if I say this correctly.
The truth has them.
Yeah, the truth has them. That's the kind of people who will be the final end time people. If they are so, if the truth is so compelling to them that they're willing to die for it, that's the kind of people who stand up to the end. Well, when a person is stubbornly and persistently rebellious against God, he is beyond, this is quoting from our Bible study guide, is beyond the possibility of forgiveness, not because God is powerless or unwilling to forgive, but because the person is not willing or able to recognize his or her sin. Therefore, he or she does not accept forgiveness through Jesus. This attitude, of course, has eternal consequences. So, to avoid even the possibility of a persistent rebellion against God, we should turn immediately to the Holy Spirit and ask for his guidance and obey God's word. Let us state once more this fact, which is so important in our understanding of this lesson. The only person that God cannot forgive is a person who persistently refuses to accept the calling of the Holy Spirit and come to Jesus and ask for forgiveness and guidance. Ellen White put it in these words, "In this our day, men have placed themselves where they are wholly unable to fulfill the conditions of repentance and confession. Therefore, they cannot find mercy and pardon. The sin of blasphemy against the Holy Spirit does not lie in any sudden word or deed. It is the firm, determined resistance of truth and evidence."
So they're not forgiven, and yet we say God is forgiveness personified. It's a little bit of a conflict in my mind.
Well, yeah, it sounds like it, but what she's really implying is, okay, so he forgives them, what good does it do? They can't be saved.
They don't accept the forgiveness.
They don't accept the forgiveness.
But still they're forgiven.
That's right.
They didn't take the forgiveness.
Okay. If you want to use those words, that's fine. Though thus we can say without any hesitation that God can and is willing to forgive anyone who really wants forgiveness, no matter how bad your sin might have been, I mean, look at the heroes of the Bible who were murderers. Moses.
David.
I mean, we could go down the line.
Paul. The key word is willing, or that wants forgiveness.
Yeah.
They've already made a decision that way. They've made a separation on their own, and God could do all the forgiving. Stand there on the street corner or make all kinds of efforts, and people, it's rejected.
On the other hand, I think we really need to go back on this notion of aphesis in Greek, because there's a difference between a person who wants forgiveness and a person who wants remission.
Exactly, wants change.
And I'm not sure when we use the word forgiveness, we should always emphasize the healing aspect of this forgiveness as opposed to just putting away of sin.
Yeah, a lot of people think that forgiveness is a way of just getting taken care of the past. Now I can go on doing what I've been doing in the past and ask for more forgiveness.
That's the sin against the Holy Spirit, is to go against the healing power of the Holy Spirit, which is all about love, because it's going against what God is. And what is God? Yeah. He's love.
Yeah. So unfortunately, there are some who see problems in the church and others around them and feel like they need to go their own way. They can't put up with this. That's clearly a mistake. Peter, in 2 Peter 1, verses 20 and 21, says, "Above all else, however, remember that no one can explain by himself or herself a prophecy in the Scriptures. For no prophetic message will ever came just from human will, but people were under the control of the Holy Spirit as they spoke the message that came from God." So how do we become more sensitive to the work of the Holy Spirit instead of less? How can we avoid the possibility even of grieving the Holy Spirit? Well, you would think that anyone who once had felt the grip of truth, the wooing of the Holy Spirit, the wooing of Jesus, would never be able to go back. But what about Satan? What about Lucifer in heaven? You would have thought, here's someone who, no possible way he could rebel. But he did. We know that all three members of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, are in the salvation business. And they're reaching out to every one of us. They're wishing above all else that we would turn back to them, let them heal us, let them draw us, and so that we can become more like them. And that's their ultimate goal. Our kind and wonderful Father, we thank you for the privilege we have of talking about you, of having this wealth of information that we can draw from to help us understand how you feel about these issues. Help none of us or anyone who might be listening to ever be even thinking the possibility of rebelling and grieving the Holy Spirit. Thank you for this time we've had together. May it be a blessing to each one, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.